Hey folks, welcome to the first ever occult version of the Unsung Podcast.
How occult?
Well, there's definitely a pentagram somewhere on my body.
Is there?
No, there's not.
That's got to be the only thing not in your body.
There will be eventually, yeah. I mean, I do have a ram's head with flaming eyes and a burning church, so I mean, I'm getting there.
Mark's like a magic eye. If you get me to take all his clothes off and stare at him for long enough, you can see anything you want.
I do that myself sometimes when I look in the mirror.
It's a boat! It's a unicorn! Ooh.
It's the devil himself.
If they're going to pick up my unicorn and you end, that's fine.
Yeah, no, I was going to leave that on the table. We've got occult sacrifices.
Sorry,
to get
I'm
to.
Slow.
Yeah, nothing bad can happen. Sorry, before we pressed record, we were having a little topical chat about occult things, but it's not relevant this week, so you just have to try and forget we said it.
Well, Nina Nastasia is a little bit witchy.
Gothic.
Shamanic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Shamanic.
Kind of, it's tenuous.
Shamanic. So yeah, that's who we're doing this week. We are going to do a rare head-to-head episode between Vicky and myself. Mm-hmm. Imagine Mike Tyson's punch out on the Nintendo. I'm the wee guy with my back to you. Mm-hmm. And Vicky's either Mike Tyson or the guy with the glass jaw. What's his name?
Or the world.
Joe Glass.
The last thing you fight in that game is the world.
The world.
The actual world, yeah.
Vicky, does that feel right?
It tracks.
So we're going head to head on Nina Nastasia albums. Mm-hmm. My choice of the album is 2007's You Follow Me.
And my choice is 2002's The Blackened Deer.
Mm-hmm. And I want you to get
Marcus Switzerland. So we'll come back to that though, because as usual, a little bit of admin. Mark?
Yes, Chris. Man, our record club is fucking sick.
We have a sick record club. You can interpret the word sick. We each month curate albums. We buy them in bulk from bands and labels. We've got some really great records. We're going to put out a playlist actually.
We've already done one on Analog Records.
Is that already
That's already been out, yeah.
Right, mm-hmm. And we're going to do another on the Digital Record mm-hmm. Club, just to give you a taster of the stuff we're sending out. It's really good. It helps the podcast. It helps all of the labels and the artists that we're buying the stuff from. And it helps yourself, because once a month you get a really cool little surprise through the door. Remember Britannia Music? Remember when record clubs were all the thing?
No. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it was a thing.
Yep.
Yep. So, yeah, treat yourself. Join the record club. You don't have to commit to a long-term thing. You can just dip in and out, maybe a couple of months at a time, whatever you fancy, and see how you like it. But folk do like it, so mm-hmm. There you go.
Patreon.com/unsungpod. You can learn everything about it there. Everything that you get, the tiers, all the cool stuff. So yeah, please check it out. We would appreciate some money so that we can give it back to the artists that we think are worthy of greater recognition.
The look on their digital faces when you contact them out the blue and say, hey, can we have like 20 copies of your record? And they're like, what? Oh my God, we're going to eat this month.
That sacrifice worked.
Yeah, totally. There we go. Tying up the loose ends.
Oh, yeah.
And if you're a commitmentophobe, then you can just join at the base level and enjoy the AAA pass where you get to influence the show and enjoy all the bonus episodes. And most importantly, you get your episodes before the weekend rather than after the weekend, so you can listen to them during the weekend. Mm-hmm. Anyway, this week, we've got a pretty wide-ranging discussion to have here. As we say, we're going to discuss Nina Nastasia. New to you, Mark?
Yes.
Completely.
I'm surprised I haven't heard of her before, because, you know, she's often mentioned in the same breath as Marissa Nadler, but yeah, what can you do?
Uh-huh. I think she may be featured in the acoustic mixtape that we did. I think I slammed one of her tracks on there at least. Nina Nastasia is somebody I actually only heard of thanks to Vicky.
You're
via the album in question, but I've since then gone on to form my own opinions.
Yep.
as a strong, independent man. And I like her a lot. I actually saw her at ATP. And
I saw her in Glasgow.
It was like, sorry, I'm going to say shellac curated, Steve Albini curated. I think it was shellac curated. I think Bob Weston had put quite a lot of things into the programme, which included Neurosis.
Interesting.
So that little crossover is going
little
to come.
Little Venn diagram there.
Yeah, totally. I'll come back. She was very good. She was, I don't know how to say this kindly without it seeming patronising. She didn't seem like a professional musician, but she was very good. She's got a very relaxed demeanour on stage. She looks like somebody that's up there that mm-hmm. never expected to be up there. Mm-hmm. I liked that. I really liked that. It was very informal and it was musically really tight.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, she just doesn't have the air of, even like Cat Power or something, you know, Cat Power has like a sort of charisma and a sort of stage presence that has a sort of level of, not training, but I don't know how to... I can't put my finger on it.
I don't know. I mean, I've seen Cat Power and she's been an absolute disaster on stage. She's understated, isn't she? She just comes out and does it. And I think I'd like read in an interview as well, somebody said this really captured it really eloquently for me. When she performs with her band, it's like chamber music. They all turn around and like congratulate each other, applaud each other and look at each other rather than the audience. It's more introspective than out the way.
Yeah.
So there is a difference in performance there when you go to see her. And I think I did pick up on that when I saw her live as well. It wasn't what I expected because her albums can be so performative and confident. Not that she, you know, it's not a confident performance. It's just that it was more, introspective possibly than I expected.
So I believe she actually did that in the studio as well, to try and elicit the same kind of performances. They would put them in the corner of the studio in a circle, facing each other, recording live. She's a long time collaborator of Steve Albini. I mean, he's recorded every single one of her records. And obviously I then saw her at a shellac curated ATP, and her music really lends itself to that sort of minimalist capture, the way he relies, rather than loads of studio techniques. He very rarely even refers to himself as a producer, just an engineer, because he's just there to put the right microphones, some of which are very expensive and very rare, but the right microphones in the right places, and to authentically capture what was happening in the room.
Yeah.
That's more his remit. And she really comes across as someone that's benefited from that approach.
Mm-hmm.
When I saw her, it was solo, and it was very intimate, but at the same time, it's a very busy room and she commanded it, which isn't that easy at a festival when people are semi-legless. Great artist. There's not a great deal of Nina Nastasia kind of wider lore or backstory online, and so there's not really a lot to report in that sense. It's not some giant musical family or some huge sort of...
Seems like she kind of ambled into it.
Exactly, yeah. As I said, consistent with her persona, I don't think she really ever expected to be a professional musician, but she was, and it wasn't by pure chance. She seems like a normal person, worked normal jobs for some time, and with an understated talent who ended up pushing on to a higher level in a musical career that they didn't bank on.
Yeah.
But an inescapable part of Nina Nastasia's story has emerged in the last couple of years following the suicide of her partner of more than 25 years, as well as her manager, producer, co-writer. That's all the same person, by the way. It wasn't some giant bloodbath. And the picture of their relationship that's emerged subsequently, including more than a decade during which she more or less retreated from her career, has really cast a different light on the music that she had made previously, as well as her newer material. But to deal with some basics, Nina Nastasia was originally from Southern California. Her mother died when she was just 18. She's been quoted on this subject saying she would go through cortisone psychosis due to the steroid medication she took for her lung condition. Some of those episodes were quite scary. There was a moment where she pulled me out of the shower and said, oh my God, the house is on fire. Or she'd be talking on the phone and nobody was there. So there's elements of trauma in her, in her teens, right up towards her mother's death. She eventually relocated to New York City, and she had been playing just small shows originally around Los Angeles and then New York City between shifts and crappy jobs when she met Kennan Gudjonsson in 1995. And she credits him with influencing the transition into a more serious career in music. It's probably noteworthy as well that she had a period of PTSD following a two-day ayahuasca trip, which apparently went very wrong for her. She's spoken about this. Maybe I wasn't in a good mental state to be doing something like that, because I ended up getting PTSD, persistent psychosis, horrible anxiety. I was bedridden for almost a year. That's fucking nightmarish. Absolutely nightmarish. I can only imagine. She took medication for that year to try and regain control of her anxiety and her thinking patterns. And wow, I find that a really horrific thing to try and put myself mentally in the space of, because having had issues with mental health, I've always felt such a fragile thing and been terrified of what if one of those experiences goes off the rails. Mm-hmm. Is there any coming back? And wow. And I think the experience and the year of dependency that followed that year she's describing in bed, presents an interesting segue into the story of Nina Nastasia and her partner, manager, Kennan Gudjonsson. Kennan Gudjonsson, for more than 25 years, has been synonymous with Nina Nastasia. He was her manager, unofficial producer, but producer and even art director, among many other things. Apparently they'd only known each other for a few days when they moved in together. Originally, he moved into her apartment in Chelsea, New York in 1995.
That's always a good sign, isn't it?
Don't listen to your folks. If he wants to move in straight away, it'll be absolutely fine. Now, she ended her relationship with him on January 26th of 2020, and he committed suicide the following day. Now, that's a bit of a mic drop. We'll parse this, and it's worth saying that this episode's going to involve a fairly in-depth discussion of domestic abuse, so be forewarned, please. It'll be handled with tact, because it's an important conversation to have, and she feels so, and I think that's of utmost importance, is that she wants to discuss it to try and help other people. I do think it's important, though, in saying that we don't speak on Nina Nastasia's behalf, or even paraphrase excessively, due to the sensitive nature of the topic. So I've included quite a few direct quotes from a variety of interviews that she's given in recent times in my commentary. I'll try and refer to her exact words as often as possible, because it is delicate. As we said, Gudjonsson's credited with a lot of the drive in her career to take it beyond just somebody who likes music and likes playing in bars. By her own account, it was Gudjonsson who pushed for her to approach Steve Albini, which they did just by sending a simple demo tape to him. Albini's sort of famous for being very affordable.
And to hire.
And also quite, you know, accessible, down to earth. And that made it a real option, and the quality of the studio that she then experienced had a big impact on her attitude and outlook regarding herself and regarding what she was creating. Laura Snapes, in one of the many interviews, Laura Snapes in The Guardian, says that early on Nastasia was offered a development deal, but Gudjonsson overheard label executives suggesting she alter a song and became adamant they go it alone, inspired by Steve Albini's famous 1993 essay on major label corruption. That's the one about crawling through a pit of shit to get to the other side, and it was inspired by various friends, bands, experiences of the record industry at the time. I both identify with his admiration of Albini's stance, and I find that exerting that sort of ideological pressure at the point of belligerence depressingly relatable from my own experiences and behaviour in the past. I can understand that mindset, especially when you're younger, that sort of very fundamentalist approach to rejecting the mainstream in a way that becomes quite negative, especially when you're enforcing those opinions on someone else, you know. So I thought that was an interesting bit of insight into his psychology at the time. As she tells it, the relationship became dysfunctional quite early on. Gudjonsson suffered greatly from a mental health condition that pushed him into controlling and manipulative behaviours, for which she often blamed herself. I think it is worth pointing out, though, that she has since said that she's uncomfortable with the details of the diagnosis, which was allegedly bipolar disorder, being public knowledge. She said that diagnosis was later corrected and seemed a bit sceptical about it. In fact, in her interview with Lina Bestfit, she even refused to repeat the diagnosis out loud because she didn't want to lend any credence to it.
Mm-hmm.
Undisputedly, his musical legacy is all over her first six records. She's only made seven. Unorthodox creative decisions.
He's on the cover of Dogs.
Yeah, he's on the cover of Dogs, whether he plays piano in that as well, I think. There's a lot of like really inspired inclusions, some of the best moments, to be honest, and she freely acknowledges that,
yes,
are across those albums and came from his input. In the words of an artist called Dave Thomas, who collaborated on one of the covers of her albums, Gudjonsson was reportedly a little difficult to work with, or at least he was considered so by some people, but Dave Thomas felt it was simply his fastidiousness that made some people frustrated. And indeed, Dave Thomas recalled that far from it being negative, he quite liked it. But there was a precision and a control that was a real defining factor. Nina Nastasia says, Kennan was a great editor. He had a natural ability for it. He was somebody I could bounce ideas off. He knew right away what things worked and why, and what things didn't work and why, and I learned a lot from that. I was doing all my writing in our bathroom because our apartment was so small, and sometimes he would be like, yeah, I'm not sure what you're saying here, go back in the bathroom. He had a natural ability for editing, but I think it didn't help him any. He had a lot of artistic ability, but he was constantly trying to make things better and better. He had an extraordinary brain that was so capable of so many different things, and it was the thing that destroyed him. He was constantly fighting himself. That's a perfect way to say it. The stress of it was intense, and it just became an impossible environment to survive in. She does add, he never wanted credit for anything, making artwork, producing, but he also had crushing impossible standards.
Mm-hmm.
Songwriting was joyful, but doing anything else was painful because I was always failing, then getting horrible outbursts and bad scenes after everything. I had this feeling like I was really ruining our lives because I just didn't have enough ambition or skill or was lazy.
Mm.
Like, paints a very complicated picture early on. There's a lot of admiration in what she says. Nastasia explained that she stopped recording music after the release of Outlaster, her sixth album, as a result of, quote, unhappiness, overwhelming chaos, mental illness, and my tragically dysfunctional relationship with Kennan, saying that their 25-year relationship contained abuse, control, and manipulation. She had always viewed creating music as a positive outlet during difficult times, but said her relationship with Gudjonsson had deteriorated after the release of Outlaster, to the point that recording new music, quote, became a source of absolute misery. From 2002, the album you've chosen, The Blackened Air, onwards, her, quote, crushed self-worth and loss of control began to colour her songs.
We work so hard just to get things done.
Later albums had recurring themes of refuge, regret, and longing to start over, but her ability to write elliptically around her subjects meant that she, as the abused, stayed hidden in plain sight. Alan Pedder's article for the Line of Best Fit has the masthead quote, Nina Nastasia has been trying to tell us something, an awful thing, obscured in the abstractions and half-told conversations of her songs, something that, for a long time, even she was shut off from. The suggestion being that within her songs, this reality had been subtly communicated all along. So this kind of starts to dig into the lyrics, and I'm curious to get your take on some of these, because you can read a lot into things that are quite ambiguous. Regarding the apparently confessional lyrics, her words are described as frequently confronting someone's frustrated ambitions with sympathy and exasperation. if that was a fairly obvious allusion, Gudjonsson didn't seem to notice. You know, in the lyrics, he either didn't notice or he deliberately ignored it. She says, quote, "He really must have separated it quite a bit, and I did too." What did you guys make of her lyrics when you're working through her stuff? Did you notice any eras in them? Did you notice any really overt messaging?
I think it's quite hard, right? Because I had mentioned to you that, oh, there are some songs on the Blackened Air, even that you look, there's definitely an antagonist in those songs and somebody who's cowering round about them, or, you know, there are these characters. But I could be reading into that retrospectively, you know. I'm not too sure. I would be wary of going back, and I think it's an interesting exercise and to go back and look, and I dare say it would be pretty impossible for there not to be some evidence there. But I think it's quite hard to say one way or the other. Yeah. Because she's very into storytelling as well. I mean, she's from LA, living in New York. The Blackened Air sounds like she's from, like, Louisiana or something like that. But I'm still lonely and I'm not ready. You scared me when you hid behind. She tells stories and she paints pictures. Are they all autobiographical? I don't know.
Nothing particularly jumped out at me as being confessional in that sense. It did feel more narrative, and not knowing the context, it just was like somebody telling a good yarn for a lot of it, you know, and that's one of the things I appreciated about it. Part of maybe when you're in that close relationship with somebody, making it opaque when they are scrutinising your work is something you're going to do both consciously and unconsciously.
Mm-hmm. One of the things I was wary of was trying to maintain some sort of objectivity, because it was clear in the media after this story came out, people finally had a sort of toehold on Nina Nastasia. They had an angle that they wanted to pursue, and every single piece, obviously, it was a big thing, but it pursued that same angle. I mean, we're pursuing that same angle to some extent as well. Mm-hmm. But the narrative took shape, and I think it gave people the opportunity to reinterpret things through this lens that maybe weren't entirely fit for reinterpretation, as you say.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe they were completely narrativized things of other people's lives and characters and abstract scenarios. She does say that at the time of Blackened Air, she was about 2 years into that period of domestic trouble and dysfunction, I think is the word that she used for it.
It's a codependency in that relationship. I think there's elements of, you know, when you mentioned about the ayahuasca, they were taking that, I think both of them took it to try and fix their relationship, didn't they? And then she ended up quite ill, and that was bad for her, but seemed to suit him in some way because she was immobilised.
Yeah, yeah. And also, it's probably a good point for us to just stress here, like, Nina Nastasia as an artist and an individual absolutely should not be defined by this. You know, this is somebody that I think it has become the dominant narrative in discussion of her, but she was an artist for 20 years, way more than 20 years before it. However, there is no getting away from the fact that the revelations about those circumstances, combined with the context in which it's now placed her work, is a huge theme. It's just a huge and unavoidable theme when you're looking at what she did. Somewhat belittled, I think, and made to feel completely incapable by her own accounts. Nastasia ultimately, quote, lost control of everything. Her emails, her phone calls, her finances, he began to really close her off. Apparently they saw a couple therapists, but Gudjonsson limited what they could even discuss at the therapy sessions. His control intensified. She says her friends had no idea. She couldn't really see them much, and she said, "I was on a shorter and shorter leash. It became like the place I was living just got smaller and smaller until it was this box I couldn't really move in." She's been keen to discuss this situation publicly as a means to encourage other people, especially women, to identify and act upon toxic situations sooner. So I just want to emphasise that us going into this detail is hopefully to some extent honouring her wishes, because what she then goes on to describe is how long it took her to recognise where she was in her life, how she got to such a constrained, oppressive, unhappy place by degrees, and then found ways to ignore it and hide it.
I find that really relatable, actually, you know, it is hard to recognise abuse in a relationship, and sometimes you do internalise it and try to change something about yourself, which is something that she says a lot. She really internalised it. She thought, there's something wrong with me. It's me that needs to change something. That's why it's not working. It gets a grip on your ability to appraise situations, especially because they were living in such close proximity. Like, that sounds like a tiny small apartment they were staying in. There's not nowhere else you can go, really. You're in each other's spaces all the time. And was there a quote where she said that she felt like she wanted the abuse to be physical, because then she felt like that was something that she could recognise and go, oh, that's not healthy. But because it wasn't that, there's a lot of rationalising things in your head or attributing them to other things. Certainly, I think that I've had a wee bit of that in the past, where I've thought, oh, I need to just work on this aspect of myself, or I need to be more understanding, you know. And you've just found a way to not excuse it. You don't really recognise it.
Totally unconscious, right?
She's very nuanced in the way she discusses this. I think part of the problem is that she clearly admired them so much.
Yeah.
And when someone you admire so much claims to love you back, but then gets angry and gets disappointed, and you sort of are like, well, they're so great. Maybe I must be disappointing them. I must be failing them. Mm-hmm. So it kind of works against you, your affection for them.
Well, I mean, a narcissist will keep you on a short leash anyway. Do you know what I mean? And they want you to keep searching for their approval. Uh-huh. Constantly.
But in that way, you're also keeping yourself on the short
exactly
leash.
That's what I was going to say. Yes. Like, but if you're a person which has some degree of mental, I'm going to use the word frailty, because that's clearly what these people prey on. They play on somebody in a frail mental state, because it makes them very easy to control. You know, and you don't see that when you're in it. You know, it's very difficult to look past it. I love this person, and they just want what's best for me. Yeah. Surely they do, right? But that's clearly sometimes not the case.
Well, that's interesting, because she, talking about the nuanced way she's approached it, she said, Kennan was not a bad guy. I think he knew he didn't want to be the way he was. It was like he would just have a total loss of control. It's important to acknowledge the abuse, but it's also important to ask questions about why it happened, why it went on for so long, and how it might have been possible for him to get the help he needed.
Taking turns to lead and follow to the dissonance. Love is needed.
Discussing it, I think, also matters, because not least because there's a risk of a flattening the issue and wider reporting. You know, it's filtered through a journalist and then through their editor. And, you know, there's so many stages in which it can get diluted, and then the nuance can be removed from it. It's much easier, it's frankly much more salacious, to paint a picture of abuse by very conventional metrics, and in doing that you risk, I think, both presenting a scenario that other people who are in abusive situations might not recognise. You know, as you said, well, I'm miserable, but I'm not being routinely beaten, therefore are things really all that bad for me? But also, I think, to unnecessarily defame the people involved, we have to be mindful of that as well, particularly in this case where the man is deceased and unable to defend himself. The nuance does matter. It doesn't excuse or belittle anything, but it does matter. In her own words, it did get very complicated. And I think when people talk about abusive relationships, it can be very easy to simplify things. I don't want to say or reveal anything unnecessary that could be harmful to Kennan's memory. My goal is not to blacken his name or to make him look bad. My goal is to talk about mental illness and suicide, because it's really serious. I do know that it's not black and white. People can be incredibly loving, but also be doing things that go completely against everything that means. It's confusing for me, and I still feel strange talking about it. I feel guilty, like I'm betraying him, you know. Our relationship was like hell, but there was also some real beauty in it too.
12 to 5 to pay off the doctor that he prescribes. There's kerosene in the wishing well, and I throw a penny still holding on to his hand.
What has emerged about the relationship? First off, she says that Gudjonsson was never physically abusive, despite, in the words of the Pitchfork article, the lyrics on her most recent record in particular being thick with images of bruises, blood and broken bones.
Punching.
Yeah, and the problem is there, you hear something about, oh, this happened to this person, And then there's some lyrics on an album, and this is this thing about not interpreting something objectively, you know, just you're kind of putting two together there. And it's an understandable connection. Mm-hmm. She's singing about violence, but she says that violence, physical violence, wasn't present. As she says, it's weird. Every time I say the word abuse, I feel a bit conflicted. I honestly needed a professional to sit me down and tell me, yes, that was abuse, and it can have a very similar effect to being punched. And this is where what you were saying is totally relevant. She continues, I constantly felt like I was creating a situation that was causing his behaviour. Like, if I hadn't messed up in this way, then I wouldn't have pushed him into behaving that way. I'm sure people can feel that way when they're getting hit too. It's hard to know. But I do think it's harder to identify psychological abuse as something hurtful and painful because you can't see it. I don't want to speak for what it feels like to be hit by a violent partner because it's never happened to me. But who knows? I might not have stayed in a relationship for such a long time if he had ever done that.
Yeah.
That's a really interesting observation.
Because that is such a breach of boundaries that is so clear. But a lot of the issues that emerge here are to do with boundaries. It's about people becoming their partner's counsellor and caretaker and those fulfilling those kind of roles. Mm-hmm. And I think if it gets to that kind of stage, you're in dangerous territory, you know. And I think for her, there was so many threats of, if you don't come home, I'll kill myself, or if you leave me, I'll kill myself. She then felt responsible for safeguarding his well-being and safety. And that's dysfunctional, you know.
It's really, manipulation, purely, yeah. You know, 100%.
And it's interesting how much of that the victim starts doing to themselves, and how...
I don't know how much self-awareness people have when they're doing that as well, you know.
Well, I was just going to say, like, because there's no physical line, I can envision him thinking to himself, well, I can justify my behaviour in this way because I'm not doing anything physically wrong here, mm-hmm. You know. I'm just too? Acting mm-hmm. this certain
Absolutely.
Way, you know, and
it's an easy line to tell yourself.
Yeah. So and then the first thing that popped into my head here was mission creep in the military. You know, yeah. It's like yeah. that. You know, yeah. It's slowly the line keeps moving. The more you can justify it to yourself, and the yeah. partner on the other end of it doesn't even know where the line is to begin with, mm-hmm. but it just keeps floating anyway, mm-hmm. and it makes it becomes untenable, and you don't see it until you have to look at it objectively, and you can't. It's really difficult to do, and when you're in it, yeah. you know.
It's a painful thing to do, personally, retrospectively as well, to Certainly. Look back at your own life mm-hmm. and identify, even without throwing punches, when you have been on that route that this guy was on, and it hadn't maybe gone on as long, but who knows? That's the thing, there's an identifiable quality about it as well, where you're like, maybe all of us in the right or wrong circumstances could end up in a similar place to this, either as the victim or as the aggressor here, mm-hmm. as the abuser.
I don't believe in the wisdom.
In a note accompanying the new album, she describes the last decade of their time together as black mould growing beneath the surface, undetected, and the two of us were dying and getting too weak to ever leave. And this bit, what she then spoke about, I found really interesting, because this is that thing where you find yourself in an absurd place. You're not leaving your house, you're never doing things, you can't go out without giving an account of yourself. You would never have gotten into a situation overnight like that.
It's chucking the frog into the pot of boiling water. It's,
yeah,
you don't. It exactly. wouldn't, it'll jump straight back out, but you put it in the cold water and you slowly turn it up yeah. the heat, and it.
So she says
it dies.
We got to a point where we didn't want anyone to see how ugly things could get, so we increasingly isolated from our friends and family. If anybody had any inkling that something was not quite right with us, I would convince them that things were fine. I did a lot of work to make sure nobody knew what was happening, and it was very isolating and exhausting. As a result, I would have very limited access to people. It was very controlled how long I would be able to see someone if Kennan wasn't there. My relationships with people were very one-sided and compromised. I couldn't really say anything about myself, and I had to make sure that people never really thought to ask about anything. And then I think you touched on this as well, going back to that subject of the ayahuasca trip, which was ostensibly to try and help the relationship.
To treat the relationship, yeah.
She says, I do think that for Kennan, the experience with ayahuasca did actually help him temporarily and possibly made his brain function a little better. Also, he was very kind. He was very capable. And, you know, when somebody gets sick it's easier to let other frustrations fall away. It kind of gives you a purpose. So she's talking about this year she spent incapacitated by the after effects of this really, really bad trip. She continues, but yes, I do think there were a lot of control aspects to it. When I was sick, he had a real reason to spend his time being focused on what was going on with me. It was easy to know where I was all the time and what was going on. It was when I started feeling better, it became a little harder.
Yep.
He went on to take care of a dear friend of ours who was very sick, and he became an advocate for that person. Honestly, he was remarkable. But once our friend got better as well, I think he felt pretty lost. And that is a fascinating observation of his psychology. He needed people to be dependent on him, and therefore he needed to engineer situations to maximise that dependency, because his self-esteem was presumably so low that he felt if they weren't dependent on him, they would leave him.
Guy had control issues in every aspect of his life, it seemed.
Yeah. As you said, one night he called threatening to kill himself if Nastasia didn't go home. She got friends to intercede on that occasion and planned to leave him. That's when he got his diagnosis and was medicated. And I think that diagnosis and medication sort of ameliorated the situation. And she says they ended up staying together. That's another quite common thing, is to say, oh, I need to get help. This is serious. Even if it's not maybe necessarily a sincere...
Yep.
A sincere need to get... It's a way to delay. It's a way to sort of make the other person feel guilty and sort of relinquish a little bit of the blame and responsibility.
Absolutely.
Oh, I've pathologised it. It's not my fault.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
About leaving him, she says, I did have a moment of thinking, if I don't end this now, I will never be able to do it. I've always had a strong will to survive, and so I knew I could find a way to create a life for myself outside of a relationship. But I knew that would get harder as I got older. It would get harder and harder to find the strength to end it. Did I see suicide coming? No. I mean, it was always a fear in our relationship, but to me, it seemed there was no way it could actually happen. And then she concludes, I can only feel sadness and guilt about it. Maybe I'll have other reactions to it later on. And that's a completely understandable reaction, isn't it? I mean, she left him and he killed himself. Would he have killed himself if she hadn't left him? No. Does that mean she shouldn't have left him? No.
No.
Absolutely not.
Mm-hmm.
So you're damned if you do, you're damned if you don't there.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Comes a point you need to take care of yourself, right?
She had a responsibility to herself, first and foremost.
First and foremost, yeah. I would say, yeah. I think that's hard for people sometimes to get their heads around.
Mm-hmm. And imagine how isolated she felt at that point. I mean, her mum died when she was young, but her dad had died in between. Like, her dad died just before one of her albums was released, I think literally like weeks before. And so she'd spent a lot of time with her entire world managed by this guy. Somebody who she cared a lot about, somebody who had a lot of redeeming qualities, but also had this unfillable hole of inadequacy that no matter how much she was in his life, it wasn't enough. I think that's a really interesting phenomenon.
Mm-hmm.
All the seasons go the same. Outside the
So that's the personal story of Nina Nastasia. That's what's really emerged in the last 2 years,
yeah.
Really. So he killed himself in January of 2020, and then almost immediately went into COVID time, you know, where we were all trapped in this fucking quasi-reality. She's described some of the aftermath of that, you know, keeping his personal effects outside the house for his family to go and see and take what they needed, recreating his studio setup, I think. I think he was found in his studio where he killed himself. She mercifully, I don't think, saw him. I think it was actually her friend had gone with her, and he asked her not to look in the window. He would do it because I think they suspected something was going on.
Mm-hmm.
And it was him that saw him. Although she did say that later she asked for details that she wished she hadn't asked for, because they now haunt her somewhat. Yeah. The writer, Alan Pedder of Line of Best Fit, I think he's reasonably friendly with her beyond just the journalism, and he observed that Nastasia's experience was a variation of a story that's played out with sickening frequency throughout music history. He helped her realise the greatness he saw in her, and he also controlled and abused her. And I thought that's fascinating, and maybe it would be worth our while reflecting on that, because it's got to be about a dozen times in this show that this theme has come up over the years now. A guy helping a female musician's career,
And then taking ownership
of her.
and turf
as well. So I thought we could maybe talk about a couple of examples, and also just generally this trend within musicians, domestic abuse. I mean, it's a trend in society in general, but clearly with high profile individuals come high profile cases. So I'd made a little list, and I think it'd be interesting to pick out some of these. I mean, one that I think is really interesting because he's so fucking celebrated is James Brown.
I read about him recently.
Yeah, I mean, James Brown had two wives that lodged complaints of routine domestic violence. He's got a rape allegation against him as well. His daughter, Yama, released a book called Cold Sweat, which was about how violent her childhood had been.
I think he took a lot of PCP, James Brown, didn't he?
Yeah, he also just seems to just come from a generation where that was just so taken for granted. And I think a lot of his peers are testament to that, you know. Another one would be Chris Brown.
Oh, right. Yes, of course, with Rihanna.
Rihanna. Is that, did he not throw her out of a, push her out of a moving car?
No, he battered her. Uh-huh. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
An interesting one, though, that still has a diehard following.
Does he? I thought he got his kind of reckoning.
Oh, he's even bigger than he's ever been.
Oh, is he?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Remember we did that show about Cancelled? Looking at the audiences and the support and the uptake on certain artists, like Chris Brown's one that's survived.
I don't know.
I think he just became a bit of an icon for those kind of guys, like guys that think that feminism's out of control. You know, it just became a sort of icon for ultra macho men should put women in their place.
Mm-hmm.
John Lennon. There's one that people are prefer not to think about.
What did John Lennon do?
He's a massive wife beater.
Yeah, John Lennon.
And his kids, one of his kids, was it Sean or was it Julian?
Julian.
Nah, hey, he was a really bad dad to Julian. Really,
hey, Jude.
Really bad.
I knew about Julian, but he wasn't a great dad to Julian. Did he batter his wives?
His first wife.
First wife. And really? Apparently Yoko, it was with Yoko as well, but that was reciprocal, I think. She would beat him up as well or some shit like that.
I knew he did some horrendous, humiliating shit to her, like going into rooms at parties and having sex with people really loud when she was in the other room, just totally degrading kind of stuff. I didn't realise.
Yeah, real stand-up guy.
Mm-hmm. Miles Davis is a guy.
Miles Davis is a good example.
A guy that admitted it fairly freely. I think one that I find really interesting is Mark E. Smith. Mr. Pharmacist, can you help me out today in your usual lovely way? Because a lot of people don't want to acknowledge that about Mark E. Smith. He's one of those figures described, I think, quite fittingly by Pitchfork in an article as, at his worst, a petty, controlling man with significant substance abuse issues that heightened his most malevolent tendencies and often manifested via verbal and physical violence towards those closest to him. His ex-wife, Brix Smith Start, who was in his band, is a fairly frank account in her book about that.
He did nothing to hide it either.
It's really strange because of the circles that Mark E. Smith's revered in, though. That's what I mean. I mean, Chris Brown... Sorry, call me a cultural elitist, but I think it's less surprising that a bunch of macho douchebags revere Chris Brown, but Mark E. Smith, it's more they look the other way, you know. Chris Brown, they don't look the other way, they know what he did, they don't give a shit.
Mm-hmm.
Mark E. Smith, it's kind of like, it's pretty buried, it's got a bit of the bowies about it, boys. Ike Turner, obviously, and Wilson Pickett, and I think they kind of like overlap with that sort of James Brown era of unaccountability. Bobby Brown, it's a big example with Whitney Houston. Phil Spector.
Oh,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
Nina Simone's husband as well. I think he was maybe our manager as well, and he really abused her. I don't know the guy's name.
An interesting one's Marty Crandall, and this is a guy from The Shins. Don't go thinking you gotta be tough, play like a star. And apparently he was locked up for assaulting Elise Sewell. But interestingly, she was also locked up for assaulting him. And I think that's an interesting one to explore because of the reciprocity in it, but also because of how it affected perceptions of the bands. Because for me, at least, The Shins became a band with an asterisk.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, they've prospered. In fact, arguably, they got bigger in the record that came out after that. But... it was just interesting to watch the, you know, the water get slightly sullied.
Yeah.
Brian Jones hit Anita Pallenberg so hard he broke his hand on her face at one point. Extantasian, we talked about him on that show. A battery of a pregnant woman assault by strangulation. Scott Wayland, Stone Temple Pilots, substance abuse issues, big part of that. Tommy Lee, arrested in 94 and 98 for domestic violence, and Vince Neil, also arrested twice.
Mm-hmm.
Ozzy Osbourne, lifted in 1989, apparently for
trying to kill her.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Then we've got a belter here, Slash, arrested for it. Axl Rose, sued, and also sued his girlfriend for domestic violence, like, so they sued each other. And Steve Adler, the Guns N' Roses drummer, almost got the full set there. I don't know what Duff McKagan got up to, but Vanilla Ice, arrested for it three times.
He's a piece of shit.
Yeah. Flavor Flav.
Flavor Flav.
Mm-hmm. Flav.
Flavor Flav, yeah.
We did this in the Public Enemy, so that's a joke coming back around.
Okay.
Arrested also for drugs, also for assault with a deadly weapon, and also for attempted murder.
Mm-hmm.
Doing well. Mm-hmm. Rick Allen, excuse the comedy, Rick Allen, the one-handed Def Leppard drummer, arrested for it. Glenn Campbell, repeatedly arrested for it.
Really?
Apparently Glenn Campbell was a real piece of shit.
That's something we missed out of the Beach Boys episode.
Mm-hmm. And he was also involved in a hit and run. And so, I mean, we're scratching the surface here. These are some of the biggest names, though. And that this is without mentioning the pedos as well, you know. And in film, obviously, Mel Gibson, Sean Penn with Madonna, Steven Seagal, Mickey Rourke. I mean, Steven Seagal seems like such a nice guy other than that as well. It's a bit of a shock, but Mickey Rourke, Christian Slater, 59 days in jail for it. James Caan, Dudley Moore, Josh Brolin, fucking evil.
Josh Brolin did?
Josh Brolin. Evil Knievel, arrested for assault, arrested for kidnapping, battery and theft. Evil fucking Knievel.
There was that guy out of Kasabian as well, wasn't there?
Yeah.
Oh, aye. Mm-hmm.
Stone Cold Steve Austin.
Yeah. I mean,
really?
Let's not go down the list of wrestlers, mate.
Yeah, no.
Nicole Avery.
Let's not do that.
So I've got that here, and let's not even get started on professional sport. I mean, it's remarkable that when you actually start to think about it, the names just keep coming. That was me just sitting there off the top of my head, mm-hmm. coming up with stuff. It's astonishing. And we have to talk about the disparity in gender here. I mean, it does seem absolutely likely that a huge number of women are abusive and violent to their partners as well.
Johnny Depp.
Amber Heard and Johnny Depp seem to have become the quintessential contemporary example of a toxic couple, maybe a bit like Marty Crandall and Elise Sewell, or Axl Rose and Stephanie Seymour.
Such vicious and anxious function.
Yeah, well, although one of them certainly fared worse than the other in that situation. Yeah. I think it's also really completely obvious that the reporting of these incidents is neither taken as seriously nor as widely documented when it's a male musician or whatever being hit by his partner. I'm sure that's the case in some scenarios. However, in terms of physical jeopardy, this isn't a symmetrical issue. You know, it's no matter how much we want to like split hairs about reporting and attitudes towards it, the physical jeopardy is just completely uneven in that discussion. Although I would say it's interesting that there is such a high suicide rate among men, and what we've talked about today with Nina Nastasia was effectively a non-physical, extremely psychological form of protracted abuse. And I think given the high rate of suicide among men, it would be interesting to see how much of that could be addressed by more serious consideration of their experiences. And that's just to try and be somewhat even-handed about it. But there's absolutely no getting away from the fact that in terms of existential immediate threat, I don't think the two are directly comparable. Unless, I suppose, it's China. You know, she got done for it as well.
Did she?
Mm-hmm. Would be a fair amount of existential threat if China was fucking pissed off at you. But
it's almost as if people that crave attention have mental health issues.
Well, this is interesting. So I was like, how often is this happening? Why? Like, without even getting too far down that road of predatory behaviour, like I said, purely in a relationship context, there are some really high profile cases, not to mention a fairly illustrious male dominated roster of artists bearing that tag of abuser, domestic abuser. And I mean, celebrity inherently sort of entails an element of entitlement, I think.
Yeah.
You know, you get that's part and the parcel of it.
It's also a complete lack of control over your own life. And
complete, I don't know about complete, but I agree with you.
Not complete, yeah, but there is a lot of control of your own life, and if you are having a hard time mentally, you will try and take control of the things you can control.
That's true.
Mm-hmm. You know, and if you mix that with a heady combination of drugs, alcohol, and sometimes even weapons.
And money
and fame, when you feel as though when you're being told every single day you're the best cunt in the world, then...
Well, that's really interesting, right? Because I agree, like, the intoxicants, whether it's drugs, alcohol, or just attention, these are intoxicants, mm-hmm. obviously. They've also got distance, constant movement, distance, lack of regular schedule. Maybe that's part of the control aspect of it. Sleep deprivation as well, a big part of it. Temptation, like the amount of opportunity to engage in extramarital activities when you're on the road. There are so many problematic behaviours that even in a normal life would be potentially a recipe for disaster. In this kind of celebrity lifestyle, they are just everywhere. Mm-hmm. Not only everywhere, they're thrown at you. And there's also, let's kind of not forget, a bit of an unofficial reward system in place for outrageous behaviour, because especially in the realm of music, they kind of incentivise excess. Notoriety is one of the greatest marketing strategies ever conceived. I mean, even in acting, Robert Downey Jr. became famous for being out of control. Look at some of these musicians who became famous for being such bastards, for being rogues. Lovable rogues. It is absolutely rewarded.
Mm-hmm. One thing that occurs to me is something that I don't think I've ever really seen it discussed is, I wonder how much of it is a learned behaviour, whether it is, you know, from their family, their upbringing, mm-hmm. or the company they kept as they were growing up, or the company they aspire to keep.
They're surrounded by enablers as well. The company they do keep are people that are
part of it.
There to enable them.
But if you come, say for example, you come from a really tough household and the only escape that you've got is playing the guitar, and you become Slash. I don't know if that's Slash's story, but you become like Slash that big, and then suddenly you're famous, and suddenly things don't matter as much because you can just pay to make it go away, or just go and get drunk, or just, you know, go and hang out with the boys in the band, and then your mental health has taken. I think there's a lot of complex factors at play which disproportionately affect people who are in situations that are not normal for humans to be in, period, mm-hmm. right? I wouldn't want to say that it's overwhelmingly affecting these particular professions, because it's obviously a huge problem, period, right? Mm-hmm. It just exists, but it's a lot of men, maybe less so now, I think, than back then. Mm-hmm. I think society...
It's less tolerated. It's exactly. still mm-hmm. clearly... endemic, but it's less tolerated. I don't know if the class thing will track anymore, though. I think now you're going to be in an environment where, because there's so few working class musicians in music, that I don't think that element of coming from a really rough background is necessarily going to be a factor. But
I mean,
you have the opposite problem of, you know, unloving households. But
that's exactly, I was going to say, like, when I say like that kind of upbringing, I'm not necessarily meaning in a class perspective. You know, I know people that are social workers that deal with children and families that work in some of the most well-off areas in Glasgow. The shit still happens there. Sometimes it can be worse because parents are so busy making money, or they've got so much power and influence.
Sent away to boarding school.
Don't give a fuck.
Yeah, you know? Fuck off to boarding school.
They pay somebody else to give a fucking. Well, okay, there's a problem when it turns out the person that actually bored you, supposed to love you, doesn't actually love you. And the person you're paying doesn't really give that much of a fuck, but is paid to give a fuck. You know, these things, yeah.
I think one of the main issues with music as well is certainly there's more of a drive to address this now, but it's to do with the representation of women in music. So music is, it's a sausage fest, right? It's a lot of men hanging out with men. And I watched this programme that was on BBC. It was a documentary about guys that had created a kind of closed Facebook page where they were sharing nudes of girls. I think they'd like hacked into the girls' phones or whatever. They were sharing these nudes and these girls were popping up and they were like appraising them, you know, different comments, some nice, some not nice. And then they were posting their addresses and names and details and all the rest of it. No, that's a different one, yeah. Right? But what was different about this one, because that Netflix documentary is about that guy that had that website and it was everybody was participating in it. They weren't really going after these girls in life or anything like that. It was more that they were doing it to raise their status among each other, mm-hmm. right? It was more about posting something to boost their popularity amongst their male peers. And music, I think it matters that it is disproportionately males because then you start to get that mentality of guys try to show off to other guys, mm-hmm. or it's the peer pressure thing, and it's the things can accelerate mm-hmm. because there's nothing there to temper it down or to change the direction. So I think the fact that there is a kind of pack of guys mentality there, I think that's possibly an interesting thing to consider as well. Mm-hmm. You know,
I think it's really particularly relevant because it doesn't even necessarily have to be superstardom. Because if there's one thing that's like that recent times have shown us, that example you're given of closed Facebook groups, even just a modicum of success can be enough to incentivize young male musicians. We're seeing it here in Scotland. To do all kinds of shady shit in places that they think they're not being watched.
Yeah.
About photos of young women, about with groupies, with the way they talk about them. And it is all about aggrandizement. It is all about how they're seen by their peers as well.
Mm-hmm.
I think also just to go back to what Mark was saying as well, you're right, what you were describing clearly are a bunch of social issues that can affect everybody. The seeds are planted with poor domestic situations, lack of intimacy with the parents. But they are much more nurtured to growth within music.
I don't know if I'd use the words nurtured to growth. I think they are left to fester.
Fester then.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yes.
One or the other. They certainly, it's an environment that is far more agreeable to seeing those through to their destructive ends.
Mm-hmm.
Then perhaps, I'm not trying to belittle the wider problem. I just mean music is a very toxic environment mm-hmm. that can really enable these things, especially if the artist is successful.
Yeah, because if you have complex mental health issues and you start seeing the lassie, right, and it turns out that you end up beating them, right, if it's just cunslaughs, right, that's going to get clamped down on by somebody pretty fucking rapidly.
My label will make it go away.
Yeah. Less likely to happen if you're famous because label will.
Absolutely.
Let's get that out of the way.
That's enabling, isn't it?
Yeah. The more you're worth, the more they've got at stake. Yeah, totally.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, all of that said, and I think that really is an interesting discussion, and I think it's important that people don't lose sight of domestic violence as an issue in music, because there's so many other issues in music that have been brought to the fore. We maybe sometimes forget that there is a core male toxicity in music that manifests in literal psychological and physical violence against the people closest to them
mm-hmm.
most often. I think that's still got to be mm-hmm. the most prevalent symptom of this. As much as you hear about your Ian Watkinses and all those kind of things, they're horrific anomalies. I think there's definitely a lot of predatory behaviour, but who's experiencing this worse than the partners? Because the partners are also the ones that are dealing with infidelity. You know, they're also the ones dealing with the consequences for the home when the male partner is away doing these things mm-hmm. and when the public finds out about it, the family are dealing with the fallout of that as well. So I think we sometimes can quite easily, that can get a little bit overlooked because uh-huh. there's so many agendas on the table now. But yeah, it's important to highlight it. It is, I mean, some of the stuff we're talking about, the extreme amount of success, the enabling and stuff, I don't think it necessarily applies in the case of Gudjonsson and Nina Nastasia. That is a much sort of slower, more insidious and a much more everyday kind of scenario that's developed there, mm-hmm. just where somebody has become, over a very long period of time, extremely manipulative. But it's interesting to see it play out when the woman had a platform to articulate it, chose not to, at least for the bulk of that time, and is now reckoning with that, and also reckoning with her role in terms of encouraging other women not to do what she did, not to tolerate it and let it fester, not to fall into the trap of excusing it, even though the psychology of that is so complicated and difficult behind it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think it is good to raise awareness of that because, you know, I've seen it myself with people that I know, that kind of manipulation that just becomes normal for that person, and you know it, you see it from afar. No doubt her friends seen it from afar, and the person in question may not always want to listen because they're not ready to face that truth yet.
Yeah, you need them to make the realisation for themselves, and so sometimes reading somebody like her saying that kind of thing might help, might put that, you know, little crack in that dam. I mean, it's a hell of a depressing thing to talk about on a show, but we've done it,
and
I
think
hopefully we did something useful there. What we'll do next week is the fun part of this, which is we'll come back and we'll have a look at Nina Nastasia's catalogue, generally. You want the air to be easy. then we'll go head to head on these two records, You Follow Me and The Blackened Air, and see who's right and Vicky who's wrong.
We've had that argument so many times.
I know. I'm curious.
And it's me.
I'm really curious, I'm right. To get Mark's taking it. But Mark, for anyone that's never seen Mark, has one monster poker face. I mean, the fact that Maestic's covered in hair,
that helps a lot, man.
Doesn't hurt. Yeah. But,
I think I've got quite a good track record of convincing Mark.
Have you?
I think so, of albums, yeah.
I don't know. I find them inscrutable. So let's see where we land. But okay. I hope that was a good episode. I hope it was well handled. And as much as you can enjoy listening to people talk about a subject like that, maybe it does some good for somebody out there.
Yeah.
And also, hopefully, it shows the kind of grace and nuance with which Nina Nastasia's addressed her experiences. And I think that was important too. It certainly made her a very relatable figure.
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
Cool. Yeah.
So, you know, one thing we've not really been getting a lot of recently, so just before we go, I just want to say that come and engage with us on this topic or any other topic any other week, you know, just drop us a comment. You know, we like all that kind of shit. We are quite open to discussion. It's just fucking, let's have at it, boys.
Yeah, we get some good comments through our Patreon sometimes.
Yeah, we do. Uh-huh.
But we also like getting them on the various socials. We tend to respond to them. So if you really want to bust our balls about something, then feel free.
I stalk them day and night.
Yeah.
Those comment sections.
Especially, I mean, they were particularly good if you liked Ace of Base or not, as the case.
I know. Oh, that's shite.
The sucking of air through teeth.
Yeah.
Catch you next week. Mm-hmm. Bye.
Bye.